everywhere. Welcome everyone to Global Outreach Program in Microbiology Malaysia 2020. First of all, I would like to welcome Dr. Adil Ali Said, a young ambassador of American Society of Microbiology, ASM, for Malaysia 2020. Dr. Adil is a senior lecturer in Water and Environmental Engineering, Department, Faculty of Civil Engineering and Built Environment, University Tun Hussein Aoun, Malaysia, UTHM. Welcome, Dr. Adil.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Khairullah. Let me start this our sharing session with Prof. Nezar. I guess in only 3 minutes, I'm going to make a promotion or share with you more information about the American Society of Microbiology. I'm going to share my slide now. Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I have to mention for all participants that this program is in collaboration between American Society of Microbiology and UTHM. American Society of Microbiology is one of the very old organizations in the world. It was founded by in 1899. They include more than 50,000 members. They are working on virus, bacteria, fungi, algae, in any different area, environment or medical. ASM, they have one very good network. You can find more information about the membership for ASM. The link, I show you the link, and I'm going to share with you the link for ASM. The benefits for the membership in ASM, that you can find all the new or the recent activity, the recent paper in the American Society of Microbiology. They have a lot of the journals, it's free access, but you need to have username and password that you will get if you are a member. I have to highlight for you that membership is free for people from developing countries like Yemen, like Middle East, and some of countries in Africa. People this come from the from Europe or USA or Malaysia, they have to pay $100 per year. Second part of today is will be on the UTHM. UTHM is one of the public university in Malaysia located at Johor. It was established by 2007 as full university. Before that, it was just only polytechnical and then college. UTHM, they have two campus, the bigger campus and also the main campus. They have around 10 faculties, including Faculty of Civil Engineering, Electrical, Mechanical, Computer and Science, and also Faculty of the Science. If you want to go and ask like Master or PhD or whatever our program in which, in any faculty, you can find more information on this website, uthm.edu.me. That's all for my presentation. Thank you so much, Dr. Khairullah. And we will come back now to you. I have to stop my share.
Thank you, Dr. Adil. And welcome again for everyone from everywhere. Also, I would like to express about my thanks and for the ASM for this activity and also for UTHM. Great thanks from all of us. About today, we have a hot topic today, inshallah. Topic today is the microbiome of oral squamous cell carcinoma. Before the topic, I would like to introduce the speaker of today to you. Speaker of today is Dr. Nezar. Dr. Nezar Al-hebshi is currently an associate professor of oral microbiology at the Kremberg School of Dentistry, Temple University, where he co-directs the Oral Microbiome Research Laboratory. He is also a primary member of the Fox Chest Cancer Center. Dr. Al-hebshi obtained his PhD from the University of Bergen, Norway, 2005, and his bachelor degree in dental surgery from the University of Science and Technology, Yemen, 1999. Before moving, Dr. Al-hebshi, before his moving to USA, he held faculty and research positions in Yemen and Saudi Arabia between 2006 and 2015. Dr. Al-hebshi has more than 40 publications and an extensive network of collaborators from different parts of the world, and has been involved as a PI in more than a million of dollars worth of research. Funding primarily from the National Institute of Health and Pennsylvania Department of Health. Dr. Al-hebshi current research focus on first, Dr. Al-hebshi focus in characterizing of oral microbiome associated with health and disease, employing targeting metabolic and metatranscriptomic sequencing. Also, Dr. Al-hebshi focusing in exploring the anti-cancer properties of health-associated oral bacteria and developing an in vitro model of subgingival microbiome optimizer of screening of microbiome modulate. Dr. Al-hebshi has an H index of 20, mashallah. Serve as a reviewer on many international journals and has presented his research findings at several international meetings across the four continents. Welcome, Dr. Nezar Al-hebshi, and you can share a slide and start your talk.
Sorry, I was muted. So thank you very much, Dr. Khairullah, for the introduction. Good evening, everyone. I know it's around 9 p.m. There in Malaysia, and it's also evening in other countries in the Middle East. It's a lovely morning here in Philadelphia. In Pennsylvania, I probably have heard about this city a lot these days in the news, because it was one of the battleground states in this election. Let me start with thanking the organizing committee for inviting me to give this lecture as part of this global outreach program or series in microbiology that is also sponsored by the American Society of Microbiology. It's a Saturday today, and the last thing one would like to do is to wake up in the morning to give a lecture, and also for you to stay late in the evening to listen to the lecture. But it's obviously our passion for science and eagerness to learn that brings us together on a weekend. So thank you very much, everyone. So today I'm going to talk about. I'm not sure how many of you are actually doing microbiome research. Can you respond to this by just saying yes or no? There in the chat. In the chat box, you can say yes or no. So just for me to have an idea of how many of you are doing actually microbiome work. Anyway, so before I get into the topic, Dr. Khairullah already introduced me, but I would like to introduce myself a bit more briefly. So I got my dental degree in 1999 from Yemen, where I'm from, and then I moved to Norway, where I did my PhD in oral microbiology. I obtained the degree in 2005 before moving back to Yemen, where I joined as a faculty at the University of Science and Technology between 2006 and 11, and where I established the first molecular research laboratory, and where I supervise several masters and PhD students. Maybe some of them are attending today. But as you know, unfortunately, by the towards the end of 2011, the situation deteriorated. So I had to move to Saudi Arabia, where I joined Jizan University, where I actually got significant support, and I was able to also obtain a good amount of funding that helped me get or boost my publication record. And between from obtaining my PhD until 2012, I extensively traveled to attend conferences, present my work, and that helped me establish a good network of collaborations and to improve the quality of my publications. And that work between obtaining my PhD until 2014-15 was my passport to the USA, where I joined Temple University in 2016, and I have been working now as an associate professor since then until today, and where I established the Oral Microbiome Research Laboratory. And I currently focus on two areas. One is modeling and modulation of the oral microbiome in vitro. So I try to use clinical samples and try to replicate the microbial community that is present in the oral cavity in vitro, and trying to find ways or methods to modulate the composition and maybe the function of the microbiome. The other area that I'm interested in is the characterization of the oral microbiome in health and disease. And actually I look at different diseases in the oral cavity, but one major area is oral cancer, which I'm going to talk to you about today. And for this work, I have so far received $1 million of funding from National Institute of Health and the Pennsylvania Department of Health. So let me start with an introduction and give you a background about the topics I'm going to talk to today about. These are microbiome, oral cancer. So let's talking about the microbiome. So the microbiome refers to all microorganisms in a particular habitat and their collective genomes. So any microbial community, all the members in that community and their collective genomes in a particular habitat is called microbiome. And the microbiome is called after the habitat it comes from. So in the case of the humans, all the microbial community colonizing our body is called the human microbiome. And even within our body, we have different subhabitats or unique microbiomes like the gut microbiome, skin microbiome, oral microbiome, and so on. And also depending on what component of the microbial community you are looking at, we can divide the or split the microbiome into bacteriome, which is the bacterial component of the community, or the fungal community, which is microbiome, or if we are looking at all the viruses in the sample, we use the term virome. So collectively, this is called the microbiome. In the literature, you will see that most of the time, people use microbiome to study the bacterial component because it's the predominant, they are the predominant microorganisms in our bodies. But strictly speaking, once we say microbiome, then we mean all microorganisms. And these microorganisms do not just colonize our body. There are trillions of these bacteria, and they surpass the number of our own cells. So there are 10 bacteria for every one human cell. Not only that, there are actually 100 bacterial genes for every human gene. And they found that these genes contribute to our metabolism. So there is an integrative metabolism between the human and bacterial genomes. And that's why we have been described or defined as superorganism, whose metabolism represents an amalgamation of microbial and human attributes. So this is one of the emerging terms over the last 20 years. Also, another term that is can be used interchangeably with superorganism of is the holobiont, that refers to the host organism and all its symbiotic microbial residents. And it emphasizes the co-evolution between the host and the microorganisms over billions of years. I know that some of you do not like the word evolution, but it is what it is. At least we know that these microorganisms learned how to, and the host learned how to mutually adapt and functionally integrate. And the microbiome confers lots of health benefits to our bodies. So it confers resistance to colonization by pathogens. It regulates the cardiovascular system. It supports our host defense function. It has also anti-inflammatory properties and also supplements us with some nutrients. It has some antioxidant activity and maintains a healthy digestive tract system and so on. But for the microbiome to do so, it has to be a balanced microbiome, or what we call as normobiosis or eubiotic microbiome. So a balanced microbial community where mostly or dominated mostly by health associated organisms, like I show in this figure that are shown here in green. But sometimes this balance is disturbed or broken to create a status of what we call as dysbiosis, which is characterized by an increase of or a decrease in health associated species, an increase of troublesome, I wouldn't say really pathogenic, troublesome species that are associated with disease. Now, these concepts, the microbiome, superorganism, dysbiosis, normobiosis concepts, actually has resulted in before talking about that, these are just example of diseases that are currently linked based on evidence to microbiome dysbiosis. So now if we go into the literature and look at and just search microbiome disease, you will find hundreds of thousands of papers that link dysbiosis to, for example, in this case, the gut microbiome to digestive problem like Crohn's disease, cystic fibrosis, musculoskeletal diseases, nervous, central nervous system diseases like Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, of course, diabetes and obesity and cancer. In the case of the oral microbiome, which I'm going to talk to you about today, the link is with the oral cancer, but also there is a link between the oral microbiome and the colon cancer again. So as I mentioned, with all these emerging concepts, there has been a shift or paradigm shift in our understanding or in the way we are trying to explore the role of microorganisms in disease. So we are moving away from the classical infections that are caused by specific pathogens, which are still applicable, like cholera, malaria, and these are all examples of classical infections caused by a pathogen in which the aim is to eliminate the causative organism, for example, by use of antibiotic or prevention by use of a vaccine. But we are moving away from this to another paradigm where we are looking at a disease as a result of microbial community imbalance. So it's our own normal flora that is shifting from a balance to an imbalance status, and that is contributing to disease. And the aim here is not to eliminate, because there isn't a species that we are trying to eliminate or is causing the problem. It's rather that we are trying to either maintain a balanced microbial community, which is normobiosis, to prevent disease, or to, in case there is already a dysbiosis, we are trying to find ways to reestablish normobiosis to treat or help with treating diseases. And the shift towards this paradigm has been facilitated by technological developments, mainly the advent of open-end molecular techniques, nucleic sequencing, nucleic acid sequencing methods. So what I mean by open-ended molecular techniques here, like for example, when we're talking about PCR, that's a closed-ended technique where we are just looking for a particular species in the sample. So we pick one set of primer or two or three, and we are looking for one or two or three species. But with open-ended molecular techniques, we are looking at everything possibly present in the sample, 200, 300, 400 species. So the technologies that developed over the last 20 years helps us comprehensively study the microbiome in terms of composition and function, and also study both the cultivable and non-cultivable components of the microbial communities. As you know, when we have a sample and culture it on an agar plate or medium, what we get is just the species that can grow in the lab. But with sequencing methods, we can also look at the non-cultivable component that could be also contributing to disease. And we can also identify novel species. Up to 2006, the only available technology was, or the major technology available was Sanger sequencing, which remains until today the gold standards in terms of accuracy. But it's increasingly replaced by next generation sequencing, as most of you know, where we can sequence thousands and thousands of samples in the same or simultaneously and generate massive amount of data. And also the availability of bioinformatic tools has helped significantly with that. And these are just showing different approaches scientists use to study the microbiome. So one way is to do targeted sequencing, where we look at a marker gene. For example, we can sequence the 16S ribosomal RNA to study the bacterial community, because it's a gene that is present in bacteria and is variable from one species to another. So by sequencing the 16S, we can characterize the bacterial community. If we want or interested in studying the fungal component of, or the fungal community or the microbiome, then we can sequence the internal transcribed spacer or ITS. And most of the studies published on microbiome use target sequencing simply because it's economical, it's cheap. And the bioinformatic analysis is not demanding. And by just amplifying the bacterial or the fungal sequences, we don't have a problem with the host sequences because they are already excluded. But the problem with the target sequences is, since we are looking at only one marker gene, so it's kingdom or domain specific. So if we are using 16S, then we are only looking at bacteria. If we are doing ITS, then we are looking at fungi. And because we need to amplify, PCI introduces biases and sequences sequencing errors. So that's a problem with targeted sequencing. And because the sequences are short and we are looking at only one gene, when we attempt to classify the sequences, most of the time we obtain low taxonomic resolution. What I mean by low taxonomic resolution, you all are microbiologists, so we have the genus, family, genus, and species and subspecies. For most microbiome studies, most of the studies would report the results to genus and family level, which is a major limitation in my mind. The alternative methods are for microbiome sequencing is metagenome sequencing and metatranscriptome sequencing. Metagenome sequencing will sequence all the DNA fragments in our sample. So it's not just amplifying a fragment, it's not only amplifying a marker gene. All the fragment sequences in the sample will be sequenced. So in this way, we can better have a higher taxonomic resolution. So we can classify our sequences to the species and even to the strain level. And because we are sequencing everything in the sample, we can see everything. That means we can detect bacteria, fungi, viruses, protozoa, whatever is present in the sample. And if it happens that we are also having host sequences, we can study the host sequences simultaneously. The problem with metagenome sequencing is that it's costly, and that if we need to exclude the host sequences, we need to add a step in the technique upstream to remove the host sequences, and then the bioinformatics analysis is challenging. Now, the problem with, or the limitation with metagenome sequencing is that we're sequencing DNA. So we don't know whether this DNA is coming from a living or dead bacteria, whether the bacteria is active or inactive. So an upgrade to this is to do a metatranscript sequencing. Do you all hear me? Okay. So in metatranscript sequencing, instead of sequencing DNA, we sequence the transcripts that are produced by active bacteria. That means we are sequencing messenger RNA. Again, we are sequencing everything in the sample. So if we obtain the sample from the oral cavity or from the gut, we extract our messenger RNA and sequence it. That will give us an idea about everything present in the sample, host sequences, microbial. Again, like the metagenome sequencing, it will allow us to do high taxonomic resolution, study all kingdoms. But the advantage is that we are looking now at the activity and actual function. And remember, this is very important for our discussion later. that with metadata transcriptome sequencing, we are able to study the function of the microbial community, not only the structure or composition. It remains costly and a bit technically challenging in terms of the preparation of the libraries and depletion of ribosomal RNA sequencing and also the bioinformatic analysis. So that was my, I meant to make it a bit long, this background about microbiomes, so, because I know that most of you are microbiologists or interested in microbiology, or some of you are doing like really microbiome. And it's also important for understanding of what I'm going to share with you from my own work in a few minutes. Now let's go back. So I talked a bit about the microbiome. Now let me introduce oral cancer. So oral cancer simply is refers to malignancies that affect the oral cavity proper. And if we, it's the 14th most prevalent malignancy worldwide. If we add to that the oropharynx or the pharynx, then the rank moves up to the sixth. And oral cancer is one of the highest or most prevalent or incident malignancies in some parts of the world, like Sri Lanka and India and Taiwan, where it ranks number one or two, especially among males. And it's accounts for... please, everyone, mute your microphones. I have some echo here. And it accounts for around 350,000 new cases every year. Half of them, or half of this number, will eventually die. And despite the advances in surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy, the five-year survival rates remain below 50%, which is one of the lowest for major cancers. So there are other cancer types that are treatable, but the challenge continues with oral cancer. Many of you would know that the major risk factors of oral cancer is tobacco use, smoking, smokeless tobacco in Yemen. The major cause of cancer is shamma. It's not qat as some people would think. Maybe it's contributing, but the major cause of oral squamous cell carcinoma in Yemen is shamma, which is a form of smokeless tobacco. And we have shown this in some of our work that I did in Yemen before moving. Of course, in the West, alcohol consumption contributes significantly. And now HPV is also an emerging cause of oral cancer, particularly tonsillar cancer, because of the increase in weird sexual behaviors. Although we know that these are the risk or major risk factors of oral cancer, 15% of cases are still not accounted for by these risk factors. That means that there are other possibly risk factors which is driving researchers, scientists to look and explore further. And one of the areas that is gaining increasing attention is the role of bacteria and the microbiome as a whole in oral carcinogenesis. And this has been inspired by the established role of H. pylori in gastric cancer. So that was the start when we realized that bacteria can contribute to carcinogenesis. And from that point on, researchers have been really involved in research to explore the role of other microorganisms and other types of cancer, including the oral cancer. Now, within the context of oral squamous cell carcinoma, there has been considerable amount of work, particularly in vitro and animal work, where they found that two predental pathogens, namely Fusobacterium nucleatum and P. gingivalis, have carcinogenic properties. So again, these two species are associated with predental disease for you who are not dentists. That means the inflammation or infection around the tooth, of all the structures or around the teeth that eventually lead to mobility of the, and eventually losing the teeth. So predentitis is also, as a chronic disease, has been linked in the literature to oral cancer. So it makes sense that scientists have particularly focused on these two species, and putting the evidence or the results from these different papers, we came up with this figure summarizing the mechanisms by which oral bacteria contribute to oral carcinogenesis, particularly these two species. So they may inhibit apoptosis. They can contribute to activation of cell proliferation, promotion of cellular invasion, and induction of chronic inflammation. And this is important. Chronic inflammation is important for progression, for induction progression of cancer. So something that you remember as I continue my lecture. There are other species other than these two, than Pigeon gevalis and Fusobacterium nucleatum, like Streptococcus and Neisseria, that are capable of converting alcohol to acetaldehyde, and acetaldehyde is a carcinogenic compound. So this explains also why people who drink alcohol can have a high risk of developing oral cancer. Now, what about, what I talked about is mainly based on in vitro experiments and animal experiments. So what about microbial studies or epidemiological studies involving analysis of clinical samples? Between 1998, when was the first study, and 2010, there were only few studies on the microbiome associated with oral cancer. But from 2000 on until today, there has been an explosion in these studies. And as I mentioned, this has been facilitated by the emergence of the concept of microbiome, and of course the advent of next generation sequencing platforms. And out of these studies that had been published between 2010 and 2020, I personally have three studies that I did in collaboration with researchers from other parts of the world that I'm going to talk or introduce you to in a few slides. But even before starting this microbiome work, I had a concern before I started. I realized that there had been a lack of high resolution taxonomy assignment algorithm. What I mean by this is that when you look at the literature and published studies at that time, most of the studies reported the results to the genus or family level when describing the composition of the microbiome or the bacteria present in the sample. They will go all the way down to the genus level and stop there. And to me, that was not sufficient and nor informative, because to us oral microbiologists, many species could be pathogenic or health associated, can belong to the same genus. So when you say Streptococcus or Streptococci, that doesn't mean much to me, because there are Streptococci that are disease associated and there are Streptococci that are health associated. So it was important to me, before I go into this, is to resolve this problem or the lack of a high resolution taxonomy assignment algorithm. So this is what I started to work on. So I contacted, at that time I was still in Saudi Arabia. So I reached out to a collaborator at Forsyth Institute in Cambridge here in the USA. And we worked together to develop an algorithm that we can use once we have done the sequencing. And we can throw these sequences to our bioinformatic analysis pipeline, and the output would be at the species level. So to do that, we had to work extensively over a few months to curate a number of reference databases. And then, of course, my collaborator had, because I didn't have expertise with writing scripts, so he had to write the script. And we had several modifications until we were able to establish the algorithm, and then we published it in 2014. And from that point, we used the same algorithm in all our studies. Not only us, but also other groups use the same algorithm. So let's share with you the results from my own work on the bacterium and microbiome of oral squamous cell carcinoma. What did we do? So I, as I mentioned, I was involved in three studies, one as a PI and two as a collaborator. One was on a Yemeni cohort where we studied 20 cases of oral squamous cell carcinomas. These were fresh biopsies, and 20 as a control, because it's not easy to get a tissue piece from a mouth of a healthy individual. So we had to use deep epithelial swabs as our controls, as our healthy controls. In the Sri Lankan sample, we included 25 fresh oral squamous cell carcinoma biopsies. And as a control, we wanted to change. We chose to recruit or include instead of epithelial swabs, to use benign tumors, in this case was the intraoral fibroepithelial polyp as our control. In both the Yemeni and Yemeni cohort, we did bacterial analysis or bacterium sequencing targeting the 16S ribosomal RNA gene, namely or specifically the V1 to V3 region. And in the Sri Lankan cohort, we also sequenced the ITS to look at the fungal community. Now, I don't want to go into the technical details of how we did the sequencing and how we did the bioinformatic analysis. Just for you to understand, we had our samples, we extracted the DNA, we did the sequencing, as I describe here for the 16S and ITS, and then throw all the raw data into our algorithm or our analysis pipeline. What we get from this is the microbial profiles in every sample. So one sample will have 200 species, one sample will have 300 species, and so on. So once we have these microbial profiles for the bacterial community and fungal community, we can compare the two groups, the cancer with the controls. And these are the main results from those studies. So we could clearly demonstrate that there is a difference in composition of the microbiome between cancer and health. As you can see from principal coordinate analysis here, how the cancer cases cluster together separately from the healthy cases. So all these blue are controls, and the ones in red are coming from cancer patients. And you see that they cluster together means that they are somewhat similar to each other and separately from the control samples. To some extent, we saw some separation also in the silicon samples. Now looking deeper at this and what particular species are accounting for the differences between health and disease, we do what we call as differential abundance analysis to look at what particular species are more in disease and more in health. And this is what we got. And let me take some time here explaining what we see. So what we see in red are the species that are increased in the cancer tissue. So in the Yemeni cohort, we found Physobacterium nucleatum, and this is consistent with what I showed in the previous slide and the in vitro work that shows that Physobacterium nucleatum has carcinogenic properties. So we were the first, although Physobacterium nucleatum was extensively studied before we did our study in vitro and also in colon cancer, but we were the first group to show that Physobacterium nucleatum is associated with oral cancer based on analysis of clinical samples. And then other species like Pseudomonas, Campylobacter, Leptotrichia, and so on. And the ones in the green are these species that were increased, or we saw that were increased in the healthy tissue, like Rothia, mucilaginosa, and Streptococcus mitis, and so on. Now, if you look at the Sri Lankan cohort, the species are different that we found in the tumors. And if you compare here with the Yemeni samples, they are different. We find Campylobacter. So although health and disease are different, but the particular species are not the same in the two cohorts. Maybe the health associated species is somewhat the same. We see here Streptococcus mitis, here the same, Rothia, and we see a Rothia here, but for the disease associated, they were not. And I'll explain this and the importance of this in a few slides. As I mentioned, we also looked at the fungal community in the Sri Lankan cohort. And although overall we didn't see clustering or separation based on the overall microbiome profile, but when we did differential analysis, we saw that Candida albicans was highly associated with cancer. And that was not a surprise because there is also good evidence to suggest Candida albicans may play a role in oral carcinogenesis. But probably the first time using microbiome sequencing method. But that was not the only species. We found another Candida species and a potentially novel species. But what was really interesting to me is that we found a number of other species to be associated with the benign tumors or were not present at all in the tumor sample. Some of these are Malassezia species that are typically found in the skin, and Aspergillus and Alternaria and so on. And what is interesting about these species, when I searched the literature, is that found that some of them have anti-cancer properties. So it would be interesting to see if these are there that just by chance, or they are really protecting our oral cavity from developing cancer. We don't know. It could be just a coincidence, but we have to explore this further. Now, we were not on our own doing this work. By the time we published our three papers, there were another 30 papers published. So there were other groups interested in this from different parts of the world. So we thought that it's very important to put everything together and look at the overall evidence. What do we learn from all these papers? And this is what we did in one review article that we published in 2016, and it's one now of the most highly of the most cited articles in the area. And last year we had an updated review, because there have been increasing number of publications and a bit changes in some of the concepts. And in these two, or from these two review articles, this is what we found: that the results from studies have been largely inconsistent. So it's not easy to see the same species in cancer or associated with cancer from all these different studies around the world. Maybe Fusobacterium nucleatum is the only exception, where at least in 50% of the studies, they found it to be associated with cancer. But otherwise, you cannot pinpoint one or two or three particular species that to be associated with oral cancer. And we attributed this in our reviews to methodological variations between the studies. Some studies use saliva, some studies use swabs, others use biopsies. The analysis method was different. Some use PCR, others use DNA hybridization, and even studies that use nucleic acid sequencing use different approach, different primers, and targeted different region of the 16S, and so on. And there have been also differences in the control groups. So some would use matched normal from the other side of the cavity. Some will use healthy individuals. We did use benign lesions. So the differences between the different study could come from this. But we also think, now before moving to that. So based on this, we found that the main findings is that yes, there are viable bacteria within oral squamous cell carcinoma tissue. In one study, they showed that there is a viable bacteria inside the tumor. So it's not just on the surface. And all studies agrees that the composition of the microbiome associated with cancer is different from health, for sure. But we cannot pinpoint, or we cannot, there is no consensus of what particular species or particular is particularly associated with oral cancer. As I mentioned, the only exception now is maybe Fusobacterium nucleatum, that we and maybe other groups showed to be consistently associated with oral cancer, but still we don't see it in all tumors, we don't see it in all studies. So how would we explain this? To us, that initially looked as if we are reaching a dead end. Should we give up, or should we continue? Or maybe if we continue, we can find something. Fortunately, there has been again some paradigm shifts that motivated us to continue and move in a bit different direction. One thing is the emergence of the concept of functional redundancy. This is very important for anyone doing microbiome research. That means that different species frequently can serve the same functions in their community and thus substitute for each other. Let's take a soccer or football team as an example. You can replace players. You can take one player out and replace with another player, but they would still do the same job and score goals, right? So in terms of the microbiome, many species can have the same genes and have the same function. So even if there are two cases of cancer with different microbiome profiles, the species in these two different samples serve the same function. So that's possibly the explanation for why we are seeing differences in the composition of the microbiome in association with oral cancer from different studies. And this has now convinced scientists to move away from compositional to functional microanalysis. So we although it's important to characterize at the species level or whatever, but also it is even more important to look at the composition of the microbiome. And that means that we have also to change the methods that we use to analyze the microbiome. And also it's very important to look at all microorganisms simultaneously. So it's not enough just to look at the bacterial component of the microbiome or the fungal separately. If we can look at all microorganisms and maybe see how they interact, what I refer to as interkingdom interaction, and there have been evidence showing that fungi and bacteria in the oral cavity interact in many diseases. So actually we did some functional prediction, because when we did our studies, that was not functional analysis, that was composition analysis. But we were able to do some functional prediction on the data. And if you go back now to the results that I shared with you from the Yemeni cohort and Sri Lankan cohort, let me go back to this. As I mentioned, you can see the species here associated with the Sri Lankan, with cancer in the Sri Lankan cohort was almost entirely different from the species that are associated with cancer in the in Yemenis. But when we did functional prediction, looking at the function of this microbiome, what we found was very interesting. We found that indeed there are similarities between the Yemeni cohort and Sri Lankan cohort in terms of function. So we could see that lipopolysaccharide biosynthesis was among the highly enriched functions in the tumors in both the Yemeni and Sri Lankan cohorts. And looking at these attributes, we realized that most of them are pro-inflammatory attributes. So that led us to conclude that the microbiome within the tumors contribute to or induce a state of inflammation that is inductive or contributes to the development of or progression of cancer. And we were the first groups to describe the microbiome in association with oral cancer as inflammatory. Unfortunately, we were not the only ones. As soon after we published this, one group from Florida, although using small sample size, they also showed using rather than 16S sequencing, they used the right approach, actually. They used meta-transcriptome sequencing. They showed that also, although the composition of the microbiome was different between the different samples they had, when they did functional analysis, they also found pro-inflammatory attributes enriched in the tumors compared to healthy samples. So an attempt to put all of this together, all these ideas, all these results together, we in our latest review article developed a new model that we called it a passenger turning driver model for the role of the oral cancer in the role of microbiome in oral cancer. And in this model, we proposed that what happens initially when we have the cancer in the early stages, the microenvironment of the cancer will select for some of the species that are present in the oral cavity that are capable of adapting to this microenvironment. So only species that can survive and replicate in this microenvironment will be recruited to the inside of the tumor. So initially, these changes or this microbiome that we see in the early stages of the cancer is rather passenger. So they are not contributing to the disease. They are just a bystanders, or they are a result of the carcinogenic process itself. But with time, this microbiome develops, matures, and starts to express pro-inflammatory attributes. And these pro-inflammatory attributes result in a sustained inflammation that in turn contribute to tumor proliferation, tumor invasion, and metastasis. Now, this remains as a model, and we need to confirm it with further work. But this is, at least in our mind, was the best we could conclude from all the previous publications. Now, where do we go from here? I'm taking this in three different directions. One is to continue this functional aspect of looking at the function of the microbiome inside. So instead of looking at the composition, I am moving away and looking and focusing on the function of the microbiome and also interkingdom interaction. And this time, instead of using ITS sequencing or 16S, where you look at just marker gene, I'm looking at the entire transcript or messenger RNA in the sample, which I called in a previous slide or referred to as metatranscriptome sequencing. And this is a grant that I received last year from National Institute of Dentocranial Research, or NIH. But it's we are still in the early stages of the project, so I don't have much to share with you. One thing also, which is really totally different, because looking at the literature, you see that most, if not all, researchers are just focusing on dysbiosis, pathogenic changes, bacteria that are associated with disease, the bad guys. Now, what about the good bacteria in the oral cavity, the commensals, the ones that are associated with health? Are they doing anything? Are they contributing? Are they helping? Are they preventing oral cancer? So I just wanted also to look at that, the other side of the coin, and look at the in vitro, at least, the effect of commensal oral bacteria on oral squamous cell carcinoma, and for which I received a grant from Pennsylvania Department of Health, which I'm going to share with you in the last few slides. One thing that I want to do in the future is to look or to explore if bacteria in the oral cavity contribute to the development of oral cancer, to induction of oral cancer. So to the role of the microbiome in early carcinogenesis by studying pre-malignant lesions. I managed to assemble a large international consortium from 9 institutions in 6 countries in 6 continents. And we submitted a large application last October to National Cancer Institute. I hope that it's successful. Usually the review process is very strict, and we are waiting for the results next year in February. Anyway, so out of these 3, as I mentioned, I have some progress with the one in the middle here, the one that was funded by the Pennsylvania Department of Health. And this is the last thing that I'm going to share with you today, if we have time, I'll go quick. So, as I mentioned, we realized from our work that there are species that are consistently associated with health. Like as you see from the Yemeni cohort and Sri Lankan, we have this Rothia species, Streptococcus mitis, Haemophilus parainfluenzae. So we wanted to see if do they play a role in protection against oral cancer. And it was not only us. Other studies showed same species like Streptococcus mitis and Haemophilus parainfluenzae to correlate or negatively correlate with the staging of cancer. So the lower the abundance of these species, or as they are depleted from the tumors, the higher the stage is. That means that probably, maybe, these are protecting or playing a protective role in oral cancer. So this is what we wanted to do, is to study the effect of selected commensal oral bacteria on proliferation of oral cancer in vitro, and to see how these strains change the gene expression of the host in terms of proliferation, inflammation, invasion, and stemness. And then if we have any promising strains, we can do a full transcriptome or global transcriptome profiling. So this is what we did. And this was a very extensive work, very large experiments that we had to do over 2 years, because we had 7 species, bacterial species. 6 of them are health associated, the ones are in green. And then 1 pathogenic control, which is P. gingivalis. And we tested each of these against 3 cell cancer cell lines and also 1 non-cancer cell line. And we looked at both viable bacteria and how they affect these cell lines, and also lysates. So we had 2 sets of experiment, and for each set we did, we assessed the effect on proliferation using counting and ATP assay, and we looked at all these genes and expression of these genes using quantitative PCR or real-time PCR. Initially I thought I would do this work in 1 year. It took us 2.5 years. So always, we can easily underestimate the amount required to do research. 1 project takes 2 to 3 years to complete, and maybe more. And this is a very important message. I understand people with extensive collaboration and involved here and there can have many publications per year, but sometimes I become doubtful about people publishing 20, 30, 40, 50 papers per year. That's not possible if you are really involved in the details of each of these studies, and which is a requirement for being a co-author. Anyway, That was the study design where we will seed our cells in one day before the experiment, and then we expose to our bacteria. And after day one, we will extract our RNA to do the gene expression analysis. And then we will follow the cells for 3 lines to assess proliferation. So we had a huge amount of results, but I'm just going to share with you the most important findings that we found. And this paper and the results were published in an article last month. We found one bacteria, which is S. mitis, to induce cytotoxicity. As you can see here, the drop in proliferation over time. We didn't see this in the initially in the first and the other two cell lines, but when we increased the concentration, we also saw a drop, which was interesting to us. So we wanted to explore the mechanism behind that, and we found it's mediated by production of H2O2 by S. mitis. So we were able to inhibit the effect of S. mitis on the cell lines by adding of catalase, because you know catalase breaks down H2O2. So we thought that if we add catalase, if that will inhibit the effect of S. mitis, then we can confirm that is mediated by H2O2. But when we tested the same bacteria against the normal cells, because the idea of doing this to see if bacteria can help with as a treatment, or if it can have selective anti-proliferative effects against cancer, but unfortunately, it also was active against the non-cancer cells. Obviously, because the mechanism is just production of H2O2, but we cannot exclude entirely that we can use this bacteria for modulating the behavior of the tumors, which we are going to explore in a coming study. But we found other two species like Haemophilus parainfluenzae and Neisseria flavescens to also inhibit proliferation. And interestingly, in this case, we found that at least Haemophilus parainfluenzae to have selective cytotoxicity against the cancer compared to the normal cells. So if you can see here, the normal cells showed the least susceptibility to the bacteria. The bacteria was more active against the tumor cells, which is really interesting that we would like to explore this further. And for the first time, we demonstrate that these two bacteria are capable of causing cytotoxicity by intracellular infection. This is fluorescent microscopy showing the bacteria intracellularly. In terms of gene expression, the most important or significant result was that we found that the health associated species, that is the good species, downregulated CD36, which is a surface marker involved in metastasis and invasion of oral cancer. That means that if this is really going to work in vivo, we can use these bacteria to supplement maybe treatment of oral cancer, to improve the outcomes of treatment of oral cancer, since they look like they are capable of downregulating this gene. But on the other hand, which we couldn't explain really well, is that all species increased interleukin 6 tumor necrosis factor alpha, which are pro-inflammatory molecules, which are really not good for cancer. But at the end of the day, what matters is the overall effect. So this is something we would like to explore in animals, maybe in a coming study. So just to summarize the results from this study, the differential cytotoxicity by Haemophilus parainfluenzae against oral cancer cell lines was the most significant result, I think, that's worth further investigation, and also the downregulation of CD36 by all health-associated species. As I mentioned, CD36 is involved in invasiveness and metastasis. So in conclusion, from whatever I presented today, we can say that there is a unique microbiome indeed associated with oral cancer, but the composition of this microbiome varies from one case to another, which is not necessarily a contradiction. It could be simply explained by functional redundancy. Again, functional redundancy meaning that different species serving the same function. And then we need more studies to elucidate the role of the microbiome in modulating oral cancer using a functional approach, which I plan to do, and I'm sure other groups around the world are doing. Also, it's worth to look at the potential anti-cancer properties of health-associated bacteria and how can we exploit this for prevention and treatment of oral cancer. And last, which I plan to do in the future, the role of microbiome and its potential as biomarker of early carcinogenesis is something that remains to be investigated and which I would like to do. That was it. And before concluding, I would like to thank all the collaborators over the years that have contributed to this work from different parts of the world, as you can see here, and also my postdoctoral fellows who have been very busy doing some of the work that I shared with you, Divya and Vinay. That was it. And thank you very much for listening. And I'm ready for questions. And I really hope I didn't overwhelm you.
Okay, yes, please, Dr. Khairullah. Can you deal with that question? Open your mic, please.
Thank you so much for Prof. Nezar for this very nice information and very nice talk. And we'll open now for question. I saw in the chat Dr. Al-Mahdi and Dr. Abdul Mannan. Dr. Al-Mahdi?
He has left the meeting. He has another meeting. So he already put his question in the
chat box. Let me see. I see there are lots of comments. So if you can get me the question, because I don't know where it is. It's I have 170 comments here. So
For me, I have one question. You mentioned that the cancer, oral cancer, usually associated with the some of the Shema and something God in Yemen. In Yemen, so they have one thing. They said tumbaki in some of the coastal cities. Do you know that?
Yeah, I mean, it's another form of Shema. So these are all tobacco products. These are all tobacco products. In the study we did, that was a PhD project done by Dr. Akram Thabit Nasher at that time, and I was supervising him. And we collected 60 cases of cancer from a Thora hospital and 120 controls. Most of these cases actually were coming from Saada and from Hudaydah. Most of the 60 cases. Now we are talking about the hospital in Sana'a, and most cases are coming from Saada and from Hudaydah. And Shamma use or Tumbak use was exclusively associated with and strongly associated with cancer in our cohort. And I think similar studies done in Yemen and also in Jizan in Saudi Arabia, because in the south they also use Shamma extensively where oral cancer is prevalent, and they found the same results.
Okay, thank you so much, Rob.
Okay, thank you, sir. Hello, sir. Prof.
Yes.
Thank you. We are very grateful for the wonderful presentations. We have learned a lot of things from you, sir. We are so great to meet you one day, one time in any conference or any workshop.
It will be my pleasure.
Very soon, I have like three different questions, sir. I have three different questions. The first one says, do the microbiome in the oral cavity will be inherited from generation to generations based on the analyzed data of their genomes? And the second one, among the communities of the oral cavity, there's a bacterial family, fungal, and the virus family found in the oral cavity that do more harm to the human body or to the human mouth. Which one is more deadly in the death toll so far from your experience that you that you have carried out before? And the third one, in terms of the medication, since globally now this microbiome, oral microbiome is deadly, most especially in those continents like Africa that do lack so many orthodox or synthesized commercial medicines that can cut out those problems, the death toll is very, very high there. Based on that, sir, can you suggest any plant material to be used from your experience to cater for those problems that deal with the oral cavity microbiome? Thank you, sir.
Okay, let's hope I remember all the questions. But the first one was about inheritability of the microbiome. That was your first question.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have seen some studies. I mean, I didn't read in depth about how much of the microbiome is inherited and how much of it is environmentally determined. But I'm sure that part of it, 40-50%, is inherited or genetically determined, while 50% of it, of the variation we see in the microbiome, is influenced by environmental factors. For example, in the case of the oral microbiome, we also know that most of the microbiome comes from our parents. Now, whether we can say that this is really genetically determined or it's just transfer of the microbiome from the parents to the offspring, it's not easy to say. But I remember one study that I read 3, 4, 5 years ago that measured quantitatively the contribution of genetics versus environment, but I don't recall the details. If I find something, I can send to Muhanna, who can share with you. Now, to the next question was about, can you remind
me? The second one says, among the family of the microbiome, there's bacterial, fungal, and the virus.
Yeah. Now,
which one is more dead, cause death toll between?
Yeah. You know, with these studies, we are still at the stage where we are assessing association. We didn't even get to the level of causal relationship. So it's not easy to tell which is more important and which is more dangerous in a way. And it could be both that they're equally important, and through the inter-kingdom interaction that I talked about during the presentation. But we are still in the stage where we are exploring this. For sure, the major causes of cancer remain the same: tobacco use, alcohol, and HPV. Now, to what extent the microbiome contributes, adds to this, is something that we need to find out with time, and we are making some progress, but not yet to the level where we can make strong conclusions like the one you're looking for.
Okay. The last one, sir.
Now, still, I don't remember. Can you remind me? You talked about...
The last one is in terms of medications. Since some part of the world, they do not have access to good health facilities or the orthodox that can cater for those problems that cause death toll in the communities. Can you suggest any plant material, any plant family that can do away with those microbiome?
So you're talking about oral health problems, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I cannot prescribe like a plant that will do everything. And it's too early also to talk about natural products that can modulate the oral microbiome and that we can just rely on it. No, I mean, this is something I would love in the future. And that's why I'm developing my in vitro model. Or in the lab to screen large numbers of natural products to see if this. But the bottom line, the best way to keep oral health is to simply brush, clean your mouth.
Okay.
That's the simplest. Whether using a toothbrush or using a miswak or a plant stick or whatever, the mechanical debridement of the two surfaces is the best thing to do until we discover something magical to use. At the end of the day, it's all a matter of compliance, whether it's a plant that you're going to chew or a fluid that you're going to gargle with or a stick that you want to clean your mouth with. You need to be to comply, right?
Okay. Thank you, Prof. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Hello, Prof.
Hey, thank you. Another question of Dr. Al-Mahdi. Sorry.
Hello?
We will give...
Yeah, I have somebody most...
Musbau Sekiru from Nigeria.
Interesting. And Muhammad Seluho is also from Nigeria?
Yes, from Nigeria.
Interesting.
Yes, sir.
Interesting. Nice to meet you both.
Currently in Malaysia. Currently in Malaysia.
My question to you, Prof, it was a very nice presentation. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
My question here is that does excessive smoking or taking of cola nuts, maybe and other candy like chocolate and other things, increases in the numbers of the microbiomes in the mouth that can cause diseases.
You're asking about different forms of smoking other than tobacco smoking.
I mean excess smoking. Hello. Hello?
You mean excessive smoking can change the oral microbiome?
Excessive smoking, chewing of cola nuts.
I am aware of several studies that assessed the effect of smoking, tobacco smoking, or cigarette smoking on the oral microbiome. And yes, also, sir. I also did in collaboration with colleagues at Jaizan University. We looked at the microbiome changes induced by use of shamma or smokeless tobacco, and we were able to see shifts that could contribute to oral carcinogenesis. But we still, the results are preliminary. We cannot conclude, but probably
what,
yes.
What about chewing of cola nuts, sir?
I have no idea. Because I don't know what, I don't know what that is actually.
Okay, cola nuts. We call it goro in Nigeria.
Oh no, I think I heard about the name, but I'm not sure if there are studies. But I mean, it would be interesting to look at that. But I don't know. I'm not aware of studies that assess the effect.
It's a ginkgo family with more of a caffeine product.
Yes.
Interesting.
Thank you, Prof.
Thank you, everyone. Any more questions from the audience?
The question, Dr. Prof. Nezar.
Hello,
question
sir.
Of Dr. Al-Mahdi. Hello.
Okay, Dr. Al-Mahdi, what was his question?
His question is, he said, actinomycosis is caused by bacteria Actinomyces israelis.
Right.
Start with abscess and ulcer, then converted to cancer. There are any cases from your study with these bacteria, especially in Yemen and South Saudi Arabia?
Oh, no. And actinomyces is very rare in itself. And I'm not sure if it's really predisposing to oral cancer. I doubt that. And Actinomyces israeli, or israelii, or the other Actinomyces species in the oral cavity, overall, they are health associated, be it in terms of dental caries or in terms of periodontitis. They are usually on the side of healthy species. But sometimes maybe in immunocompromised patients or when they're forced deep into the tissue, they can cause actinomyces. That's a special case, a special disease. I don't think it's really linked to oral cancer. Unless he has a case report or something, I'm not sure, but I don't recall or remember that I read about that. But it's an excellent question, actually.
Mr. Nezar, I have a question.
Yes,
Dr. Abdul Manan, meeting from Netherlands.
Can Abdul Manan?
Open your mic, Dr. Abdul Manan. Open your mic.
Hello.
Thank you very much for Prof. Dr. Nezar. Please, if you can clarify how the normal flora in the mouth, which is classified as non-pathogenic, now become as risk factors or contribute to carcinogenesis. I mean, this bacteria, we don't know before is secrete any toxin or any some proteins which is can induce inflammation or like that. But now, is it any mutation happen for this bacteria to become pathogenic or only as considered as risk factors with the immune deficiency or the cancer when it's started? Maybe immunity is decreased, so it will be opportunistic bacteria or fungi.
That's a good question. Thank you very much. So it happens this way. We also know from other diseases, like let's say in the case of HIV, where members of the normal flora that are usually harmless become pathogenic, right? Let's take that as an extreme example. So it's not necessarily that you have a member of the microbiome that is usually in balance with the others and not doing harm, that when this can overgrow can also contribute to disease. Now, what happens in the case within the context of microbiome is the balance between the members of the bacterial community. So in a balanced microbial community or an eubiotic microbial community, as you can see in this figure, any potentially troublesome bacteria like those in reds are a minority. Like say in any community, like human communities, in any city, you will find some bad guys anyway, anywhere you go. But it depends on the balance between these and the rest of the community. So if the if we have predominantly the good guys taking care of everything, then you will not even see these bad guys in that because they represent a very small minority and they don't have a role to contribute. But once this balance is disturbed and we start to have these members of bad guys increase in number, now where we have, it's not easy to say pathogenic community, but it's a disturbed microbial community where the meta and the overall or the metabolic activity of this community is conductive of disease or contribute to disease. And again, for most of these, it's the amount of the level of contribution is not easy to tell. I don't think we can easily say that a microbiome is a cause of disease, but it's a risk factor or contributing factor.
Thank you very much for you.
Sure. Thank you. Doctor, I had a question here about the effect of cat chewing on the microbiome. I did some of my PhD on this, although I didn't look at the microbiome. Overall, I looked at specific types of bacteria, but I don't think you like the results. So, anyway, a science is science. So what I found in that study and on those studies when I did my PhD, because I mean, it's obviously cat is a plant, so we're full of, in high concentration, is full, like any other plant, is full of potential antibacterials. So and remember, we chew cat in the oral cavity for extended numbers of hours. So they do this mechanical clean brushing effect. So they reduce plaque, they reduce accumulation of bacteria on the teeth. And they actually, according to my studies, they reduce the number of anaerobic bacteria that are associated with periodontitis. But that's just, I'm looking at from that, only from that angle. But now what else the cat chewing does, the oral cavity, that's different thing. But now I'm just answering to the effect on oral bacteria per se. It looks like some of the components of cat help in decreasing dysbiosis. But I hope that you will not take this as an excuse to chew cat or continue chewing. هذه خطبة في from for خطبة
somewhere. Mr. Rizal, my question is, you know, oral bacteria is anaerobic, so it is difficult to cultivation. There is a specific media you cultivate or how?
Yeah, I mean, the oral cavity is a mix of different, so we have facultative as well as anaerobic bacteria, and the predominant species are streptococci, which are easy to grow. So it depends on what bacteria you are looking to isolate from the oral cavity. So if you are just trying to isolate streptococci, then you can just use the Metis salivaris agar or any agar, commonly used agar that you use. But if you start to, if you move away from these and you want to cultivate the more difficult species, the anaerobes like Physobacterium and P. gingivalis, in addition to the medium that you are going to use, you have to do all the work in an anaerobic chamber to make sure to keep. So, and then there are different media depending on the purpose, but the general media that we use to grow oral anaerobes is the fastidious blood agar.
Okay. For the metagenomics, you take swab, saliva, or tissue?
For the cancer work?
Yes.
Because what particular sample we are interested in depends on what disease we are studying. So if we are studying cancer, then swab samples or biopsies would be the best samples, obviously. If we are looking at gum inflammation or periodontal disease, which are around the tooth structure, then we go around the tooth to collect the sample. Saliva is a good surrogate sample or washout sample for the oral cavity. I don't like it much, but it's used frequently in my oral microbiome research.
Thank you, Dr.
There is another one he would like to ask.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Yes. Well, I'm going. I have one question. Sorry.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Actually, Prof. Nezar, he said no relation between the cat and maybe the oral cancer. But what about the cat that they use pesticides, a lot of pesticides, chemicals?
No, what I didn't say that cat is not related to cancer at all. What I said is that the major risk factor, the major causative reason of cancer in Yemen is the use of shamma. Because the evidence is very strong, overwhelming. We cannot deny it. Now, going back to cat, it's not easy to tell because in my own study, I didn't see association between cat and cancer. And if you look at the composition, the phytochemical composition of cat, there isn't a single substance that you can say, oh, well, this can be carcinogenic because it's full of antioxidants, tannins and anthocyanidines and polyphenols and vitamin C as well. These are all antioxidants. And biologically, these are could be the other way around. It could be anti-cancer. I mean, I'm talking science here, pure science. But now you just mentioned the extensive use of fertilizers and pesticides, and whether these are contributing to oral cancer and other cancer types, because you know these fertilizers and pesticides are not only used with cod, they're used with vegetables and with fruits. So we don't know really the extent of that of the contribution of cod to oral cancer. But if I was a health official in Yemen, my focus to reduce oral cancer, my primary focus would be shamma, for sure.
Okay, thank you so much, Prof.
Thank you. There's another question. Someone he asked.
I have a question.
Welcome.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Prof. Nezar, assalamu alaikum. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thank you.
Alhamdulillah, you remember me from technology, Sana'a, University of Science and Technology.
I don't see you.
maybe before 20 years ago.
Yeah, probably. But I don't see who's. I'm not able to see who's talking.
That is Sana'a anthropy, microbiology.
Oh yeah. Hayakallah. Yep, I remember you well.
Hayakallah. Okay, thank you very much for this huge information you present today. I have some question about. Maybe the question already, given by some of our members, but I want to repeat again some question about what is the relation between some chemicals and also such as GAT, tobacco, and also smoking cigarette. So, and oral microbial that can cause cancer. So the other question is, there are something mixed between the fungal and parasites that can cause oral cancer rather than the viral and bacteria.
Okay, let me take the other question. You're talking about parasites or maybe protozoa and fungi. Yeah. This is what I'm exploring in the current project. So I'm in my current project that is funded by NIH. I'm trying to look at all the microbial kingdoms, including fungi, bacteria, viruses, protozoa, and metazoa even. I mean, whatever, I'm going to sequence and see what we have, and archaea as well, and see if they play a different role and how they interact in oral cancer. So this is something we are exploring. Moving to the first question, you said, how can we assess the relation between smoking or tobacco use and bacteria and how that contributes to oral cancer?
Yes.
So,
I mean, what's the, okay.
The role of tobacco in oral cancer and other cancers is well established. So tobacco is highly carcinogenic and it has substances that induces mutations. So we have genetic mutations that are underlying or predisposed to oral cancer. So that's a clear role. But now, is it possible also that the use of tobacco modulates the microbiome in a way that also contributes to oral carcinogenesis? This is something we are also exploring. Yeah. As I mentioned, I did with Dr. Assam Halboub in Jaisan University, we assessed the microbiome in people who use shamma. And we found that people who use shamma have higher abundance of a species called Rothia mucilaginosa. And in other groups have shown that this particular species is capable of producing acetaldehyde. So My hypothesis is possibly is that smoking or use of smokeless tobacco or shamma can cause these microbiome shifts and make the microbiome more capable of producing acetaldehyde, and that in turn contributes to the development of oral cancer. So it's in the early stages, but I think this is a valid way to go.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Jazakallah khair.
Wa yakum.
Barakallah fikum. Dr. Nezar, you can see my email and my handphone also. I want to join you. I want to contact you.
Sure, you can take my email address from Muhanna anytime.
Yes, okay, inshallah. Thank you very much. See you, inshallah.
See you.
Okay, Dr. Khairullah. Liz, can you please? Okay.
Another one. There is another question.
Fahmi, Al-Mughallis has one question in the chat box. Where is Mr. Fahmi?
Fahim Al-Mughallis, Dr. Fahim.
Fahim.
Hello, Fahim, how are you?
What is Fahim?
Yeah, I see his question. Do tobacco products change oral microbiome balance and predispose individuals to oral cancer? I just responded to the same question that Dr. Saleh. So it's the same question. So we already responded to it.
There is one question here, Doctor. Other than herpes virus, is there any other virus correlated with oral cancer?
Other to what? Herpes?
Herpes virus, yes.
Other, I don't know, you mean human papilloma virus?
I don't know, he said like this, yes, herpes.
That's human papillomavirus. That's the virus primarily associated with in oral cancer, particularly the oropharyngeal cancer. You know the connection between human papillomavirus. Human papillomavirus is mainly responsible for cervical cancers, but because of the weird oral sex habits, it transmitted from the genital area to the oral cavity and is contributing to the development of oral cancer. Other cancers that may be involved, we know Epstein-Barr virus is an important virus is involved or has a role in nasopharyngeal cancers. Now, whether it could also contribute to cancers of the oral cavity is a possibility that we explored in the study that I mentioned by Dr. Thabit Nasher. We did real-time PCR of human papillomavirus 16 and 18 and Epstein-Barr virus in our samples. And although we didn't see a difference in the detection frequencies of Epstein-Barr virus between cases and controls, when I did some statistical modeling regression and looked at the interaction, we found some interesting results where we saw that there could be an interaction between Epstein-Barr virus and tobacco use. So that means if you are a tobacco user and you have Epstein-Barr virus, then the risk is higher of getting or developing oral cancer. There are other viruses that we are exploring or going to explore. One of the herpes viruses, and a couple of other viruses that I don't recall now, but the human papillomavirus is the classical example.
Okay, Dr. Abdul Hafiz. Where is Dr. Abdul Hafiz Nagy?
Hello, doctor.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum. Actually, I'm just wondering how to keep the oral microbiome in the healthy or normal level all the time. So because all the habits.
That's a hot area of research. How can we maintain oral microbial balance or normal viruses? That's a difficult question. Actually, I cannot, as I respond to one of the questions, it's not easy to pinpoint to one product or something that you can do to maintain normal biosis. I mean, classically, we always instructed our patients as dentists to keep on cleaning, brushing, flossing, using some oral antibacterial mouthwashes. But that's basically not keeping the balance rather than removing excess or trying to help or stop bacteria from building up in the oral cavity. Now, the concept of modulation of the oral microbiome is a hot research area that I'm personally involved in. And we are trying to explore ways like I mean, you are familiar, maybe people who are working with the gut microbiome are familiar with prebiotics and probiotics. These are these are substances or bacterial strains that we can use to enhance the profiles or encourage growth of health associated species in the gut. But their application.
So do you think the probiotic is effect to keep the oral microbiome in the normal level all the time?
Challenge oral cavity, which I actually don't like, that most studies that assessed prebiotics or probiotics particularly, they used exactly the same strains that we use for the gut microbiome, which in my mind is nonsense, because the oral microbiome is different from the gut microbiome. Most of the time we use bifidobacterium or lactobacilli as probiotics for the gut microbiome, and insisting to use the same in the oral cavity is not making sense to me. So now people are trying also to explore or to search for oral bacterial species or strains from the oral cavity that are part of the oral microbiome and use them as probiotics. But again, this is still in the early stages. I think I saw a couple of studies where they found particular strains of oral Streptococcus salivaris, if I'm not wrong, that has been used as a probiotic, and the results are promising. But we are still, and when it comes to the oral microbiome and oral health, we are still in the early stages when we want to compare with the gut microbiome, where they have made much, much, much progress compared to us.
Oh, last thing. Thank you.
Thank you. There is a question from Hassanato Waziri. The question in the chat.
It's about cancer and a pig, cat, dog, or any. I think, I'm not sure, you're saying about cancer in animals. You're saying that to use these as a model to study the interaction between microbiome and cancer in the lab, or you're talking about cancer happening in animals?
Yes.
Hassanato?
Maybe she did.
I don't know how to respond to this question. I'm not sure if animals can be affected by oral cancer. I didn't look at that, but I know that we have animal models of oral cancer, either by chemically induced or using xenografts, and people or scientists use these models to study the role of different risk factors in oral cancer, including the microbiome, and it's something that I'm planning to do in the short term.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I think we are over time. Thank you so much, Prof. Nezar.
Thank you very much to you.
You give us this part of time from your weekend in early morning. Thank you so much again. And thank you for taking
the time to organize. I appreciate your efforts to put this together.
I want to give more thanks for you because your presentation and your sound is very hot like Trump.
Exactly.
Thank you very much.
Thank you everyone.
Thank you so much. It was a wonderful presentation, actually.
Okay. And thank you also. Thank you for the organizer of the Global Outreach Program in Microbiology Malaysia 2020. Dr. Mahanna, Dr. Adel, and Dr. Naif, thank you for all and goodbye.
Yeah, I would like to thank also Mahanna and Adel for their great efforts and putting together this activity or initiative. It's amazing and impressive. I like it. And Mahanna kept on sending me email every 15 minutes. Okay, then everyone. Thank you everyone for listening, and hope to meet you in person someday.
Bye for now.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, bro.
Okay.
See you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, see you. I'm going to eat now, Paula.
Okay, thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you, Dr. Khairullah.
Thank you for all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Muhammad Sahari, for host control. Muhammad Sahari.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm going to stop everything now. Thank you so much. See you next presentation.
Inshallah, thank you.